To tell you the truth, I'd never even heard of them before I went down. I didn't even know what it was, Leeds. You know, for some obscure reason, I thought it was in Wales.
My mother could probably have went into that Leeds United side at the time and played at centre-half, because the players round about are that good.
The target at Leeds United was to win everything, and that's how colossal a club they were.
And we could mix it. Nobody liked to play against us, that's what we wanted. We wanted people to come to Elland Road and not have a nice afternoon.
It was unbelievable coming down from Scotland and you get into the dressing room for the first time. I mean, it's like opening up a football magazine, all household names, like people like Jack Charlton had won the World Cup. But of course there was a huge Scottish contingent.
This is the story of Clan Leeds, a little bit of Yorkshire that for a time in the 1970s was a piece of Scotland. Gordon McQueen, Peter Lorimer, Eddie Gray, David Harvey, Joe Jordan and Billy Bremner. Legendary Scots who added the tartan touch to Don Revie's famous Leeds United. It was the summer of 73, and in the previous decade, Revie's Elland Road teams had been winners, picking up a league title and several major trophies along the way. But they were capable of losing spectacularly too. In the season ahead, this was a side with something to prove.
We had so many disappointments, so many finals. I was in 10 finals, and I won 4. And we lost the championship, the league, on goal difference on 2 occasions, and we were second on that many 10. Never out the top 4 in 10 years.
Leeds United had just pulled down the curtain on a season which was, by their standards, a shocker. They had been humiliated in the cup final at Wembley by second division Sunderland, and the press had a field day with Revie and his players. The headline screamed that the manager would quit for Everton. But he had other plans.
I think it made Don think that the next season was going to be the most important, because he could see his side beginning to break up, I think. You know, they were getting a little bit older. And I think he realised this: the 1974 season would have been the last chance for them to do anything big together.
All he did was he showed us the press cuttings and the recordings on television of how we were finished. You know, we were too old, Don Revie had finished, the players were too old, we were rubbish, Sunderland had beat us. And that really, really riled us on.
He pulled all the players in at the beginning of the season and says, look, we're going for the league championship this year. Forget the rest, forget the league cups and all that. I am not interested.
He said, right, lads, we're going to go through the season getting, we're not going to be beaten.
Which was unbelievable at the time. He thought, ah, no, that, I mean, that just can't be done. But he believed it could.
Their time had come. Leeds United, once negative and defensive, went through a makeover. Fired up by the criticism, the First Division was about to be hit by the charge of the White Brigade.
Here's Bremner!
Everton were thrashed in the opening game, and then Spurs were swept aside in a bruising 3-0 defeat.
Here's Bremner! What terrible marking by Tottenham!
Leeds were on fire, and it was Revie who was fanning the flames. Don Revie was special. He looked on Leeds United as his second family, and he knew when to be the stern father or the benevolent uncle. In return, he received a loyalty from his players, which was, even in those days, rare. He created a team bond that was the envy of the league.
When he brought a player in, I think he looked at the player, obviously, about his ability to play the game, but also the character and personality of the player, that he would be a player that would mix, would settle in, and we'd go on with other players and vice versa.
When it was time to extend his family, Revie chose wisely. And when he discovered Eddie Gray, that meant another cross-border raid to a school on the south side of Glasgow for a chat with a reluctant headmaster.
Basically, he just says to my mother, I'm going to go up and see the headmaster. He's going to come down to Leeds, he's going to be a football player. So he went to see the headmaster, and I was standing outside the office, I'll never forget it, and he went in on his own. So I don't know what he says to the headmaster, or, you know, if he gave him anything, or, you know, I don't know. But that was it. I left school on that Monday and come down to Leeds.
Revie's family spirit was forged in the dressing room. Experience and youth side by side. Old hands who had carved out international careers were ordered to look after the kids.
When I went down, I stripped between Eddie Gray and Peter Lorimer. So that was a nice little touch where I was there. I mean, they were a few years older than myself, but it was done for a purpose.
Well, yeah, we used to call Joe the Chuchter. He used, you know, he come down. Joe was a bit dough, you know. He's a bit of a, he's a very serious lad. Lovely lad is Joe, but he has got a serious side to him. And so, obviously, if you've got that in your makeup, you're going to be on the receiving end of more stick.
The first day he came in with a black oilskin coat. I'll never forget it. He went like a fisherman and got a bit of stick about that coat, Joe. He'll never forget it. He never wore it again.
He couldn't understand it because he thought it was he was the fashion boy because he was younger than the rest.
But as soon as we seen Joe play, we knew he had something different. You know, we knew he'd be a player. Aggressive, but led the line well.
A youngster like me, inexperienced and raw, and there was no doubt I was raw in those days, and Norman would have you nearly polished by the end of the season, be pushing you, pulling you, telling you where to go, and of course, he was a phenomenal player himself.
Playing at Derby once, and I ran out, and the big man was behind me, laid on the floor. He shouted, "Don't leave me, Norm, don't leave." And he had cramp in both legs. He had just come down from Scotland, you know, he hadn't played many games. But he was a good signing, and Joe Jordan was too.
In a team of favoured sons, Billy Bremner was the golden child.
I think he certainly had a father-son relationship with Billy Bremner. I think out of all the players, that was the player that he was closest to. I don't think there's any doubt about that. And of course, he was his captain and an inspirational captain as well. You know, he had a huge influence on, obviously, on Leeds United.
When Billy Bremner took us across the white line, whether it's at Ellen Road or Anfield or Old Trafford, Stamford Bridge, those players, my team, we died for Leeds United. We died for that club. Billy was the best player I ever played with. They'll make players like him today.
Here's Bremner!
There was a stage when there was actually 17 Scots at Ellen Road, which is staggering when you hardly get any at some of the football clubs now. I mean, the English players were running around with Scottish accents at the time at Ellen Road.
For over 10 years, Don Revie was all-powerful at Leeds United. There was little interference from the board, and he was as comfortable negotiating big-money transfers as he was taking training. For the players, his brand of hands-on management proved inspiring.
Well, we do this every Thursday morning for the last 11 to 12 years. I feel it's been a great thing to them because it just relaxes them a little bit and gets the tension out of the muscle before the Saturday match.
To have a top manager getting absolutely soaked on a Thursday, rubbing everybody down. He used to massage you along with Sidoine, along with Bob English and Les Cocker, and used to massage you top and tail, turnover, exactly the same. Then you had your kind of plunge. And that's what we were used to.
His talent certainly rubbed off on the team. Unlike today's superannuated stars, the Leeds players were happy to pick up their pay in a poke.
We used to get paid weekly, but we used to get a brown envelope and we'd pay in cash.
Oh, I don't know. Nice. Did you take that one this week?
Change.
He'd say, when you're picking your wages up, don't forget to go on the players' lounge to sign those footballs that, like, youth clubs had sent in, parents. And every Thursday, when we were to pick up our wages, we must have signed between 50 and 100 footballs.
It's a cliche, but I think every player you talk to about Legion, about Don Revie, any ex-Leeds United player, I tell you, they'd run through a brick wall for him. And I think that's the way every player felt about him.
You all right, big man?
Aye.
Aye? You're not putting the back of your legs or anything, are
you? No.
Or you said you were a little bit, are you grinding or anything?
Not bad, no.
I remember once and I woke up one morning, well, I was struggling all week and I had ankles about that thick, couldn't see an ankle bone or nothing. And my missus said, "What are you going to do?" I said, "Oh, I'm going down for a fitness test." She said, "You crackers." I said, "I'm going down, don't worry. I'll be back." But then I got down there and he puts his arm round you and he said, "Come on, man, rather have a three-quarter you fit than anybody else, all the usual, you know. Go on, try it for me, son." And you'd hobble up there and you'd say, "Ah, it's not too... Go on, try that tackle, son. Ah, Les, what do you think? I'd be all right. Get a strap and on. Out you go."
Don't go and do silly things and put yourself out for Saturday. They've got the Easter programme coming on. This should be professional.
Oh, yeah, he was very clever. I mean, being a good manager, you've got to be good at man management, and that's what he was good at. When you think back on it, he's a bit of a con man, really, the way he kidded you all and that, but it was all done for the good of the team.
He had a great drive that season, and, you know, he was pushing the players and pushing them, and he wanted them to go and you know, like they went on an unbelievable run, you know, and he wanted to maintain that.
As 1973 drew to a close, Revie convinced his players they could win the league unbeaten. At the beginning of December, Leeds faced Ipswich. They were 8 points clear in the league and on the brink of equaling main rival Liverpool's record of 20 games without defeat. By now, United were a team on a mission.
Beattie underneath, not a good header, straight to Yoris. And he scored, Terry Yoris. What a disaster for Ipswich.
We never changed our formation. Why should we change our formation? We'll let them worry about us.
Jones.
Systems do not win football matches. Football players win football matches. But you play to a pattern, which we did. We play a 4-4-2. Pete Lorimer on the right wing, Eddie Gray on the left, Mick Jones on our front. And we never changed that pattern.
Clark. Rooney just inside. Yoris on the far post. Clark going in alone.
Leeds were on course to beat Liverpool's unbeaten record. And every team in the league was out to spoil the party. Chelsea were notoriously fierce rivals. In the FA Cup final of 1970, both teams had gone to war, and what was described as the dirtiest game of football ever played. The next game of the season would be against their bitter rivals.
Every game between those two clubs was a physical battle. So we had to go there, and obviously Chelsea are looking for a scalp to stop Leeds going through and completing that season undefeated.
By now, Leeds had fallen into a beautiful rhythmic style, and it was really just a matter of when the goal would come. It was Jones' 11th league goal of the season, and one he won't forget.
The Leeds team battled hard to beat the record and win over the critics who'd accused them of being more physical than skillful. But reputations are hard to shake, and Leeds were still an intimidating outfit.
I used to look at some of the games Leeds United play and I'd wince. I'd think, jeez, it's a bit brutal this game, you know. Wasn't it a game I came here to play?
The first tackle you ever had was nearly always free. The first one was a freebie. So Don Revie used to say it to me, Norman, just let them know you're there. And I didn't disappoint many people. So as it was knocked up to them, just get close to them, just hit them a bit. And if they pick themselves up and come back at you, then you knew you had a hard afternoon. But if they laid down and didn't come back, then it made your afternoon very, very easy.
There was lots of teams around who, you know, one or two of the southern teams, you know, by the time the bus came over the Trent at Nottingham, they were beat because they didn't want to come up north because they thought, woof, we'll get it today at Leeds in a muddy pitch and they'll come out and they'll steam into us. And that's how we did it, yeah. We didn't disappoint them, you know. We'd come out first 10 minutes, hit them with everything, and they were beat. You know, you could see the, you know, they just didn't want to be there. They were good memories, actually.
A lot of people give a stick about how hard we were. We used to fight for that ball simply because we were brought up as winners.
In all fairness, we were unpopular because we were the best. And I think when you were the best, people don't like you.
We got a reputation and we deserved it. You know, looking back, we did things, I did things personally that I wasn't proud of and that, and I look back at, but you did it to win.
And then there was the in-house tribal warfare. Did you hear the one about the Englishman, the Irishman, the Welshman and the Scots? For Don Revie, it was no laughing matter.
Any more in the book on a Saturday doing that?
We used to play Scotland against England, five-a-side matches. But it was like World War III. I mean, it was like some of them getting rather nasty.
And at Ellen Road at that time, we used to have 2,000 or 3,000 people down watching us training at the back of the main stand there every day. And the competition between the Scots and the English in five-a-sides, you would not believe. You would not believe. It was worth the entrance money to come in through the week to watch it. And I've seen many a scuffle between Norman and Peter and, you know, and Eddie and Jack.
No! Time up! No! No! Hit the post!